Good morning, Water's Edge. Good to see everybody this morning. Welcome to another beautiful Sunday outside on the lawn. There are some song sheets around, or did you give them all out, Holland? So a few options for the lyrics today. One would be on our Facebook page. There's a post, and in the comments, there's the lyrics. If you're on our email list, and an email went out early this morning with the lyrics in that email. And if you're not on our email list and would like to be, you can talk to this guy right here on drums before you leave today, and he'll make sure you get on the email list. Or if you'd like a handheld copy, we do have a few copies over here that my daughter has. And so if just raise your hand, she'll bring you one of those. We're glad to be out here with y'all this morning. I want to start this morning with a passage from 1 Chronicles that reminds us of one of the reasons why we're here and why we sing. And so if you'd like to follow along, this is 1 Chronicles chapter 16. Starting at verse 23, and the first seven words here explains why, one of the reasons why we're about to do what we're about to do. So it says, sing to the Lord, all the earth. So we're going to sing to the Lord this morning. Sing, but why? Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and he is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the people are worthless idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and joy are in his place. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. Yes, the world is established. It shall never be moved. Let the heavens be glad and let the earth rejoice. And let them say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Let the sea roar and all that fills it. Let the field exult and everything in it. Then shall the trees of the forest sing for joy before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Say also, save us, O God of our salvation, and gather and deliver us from among the nations, that we may give thanks to your holy name and glory in your praise. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Heavenly Father, this morning, as we sing your praise, as we look into your word, as we trust your spirit to guide us and teach us, Lord, may you be magnified and glorified. May we open our mouths and with our voices lifted up, sing, save us, O God of our salvation. May we glory in your praise this morning. May we give thanks to your holy name. In Jesus' name, amen. Y'all stand with us and let's sing together, O Great is Our God. And as we've done in the past with this song, this is one of those that, ooh, hang on a second. There it is. That's the right chord. Like, that is something. Not right there. Make a joyful noise, right? That's... doesn't have to sound good. It just has to be joyful, right? So, and we're outside, so you can make that joyful noise as loud as you want. You don't have to worry about the people around you looking at you funny. So let's raise our voices and sing, Oh, Great is Our God. And with this song, if you know the song from the past, we start with the chorus, and the chorus gets loud, and it gets high fairly quickly. And so that means you, what's the rule to sing higher? Sing louder. So let's blast it out today for the glory of God, and let's lift his holy name.
we should worship greatly.
Amen. Let's continue to worship greatly this morning. As we look at this last part of Acts chapter 2 this morning, we're going to see the beginnings of the church. We're going to see the beginnings of the church gathering together and fellowshipping with one another and caring for each other and giving to each other. Where does it start? It starts with freedom in Christ. It starts with them recognizing that if the Son has set you free, then you are truly free. So we want to remind ourselves this morning of what God has done for us through the cross of Christ and through the resurrection, that He's broken our chains of sin and shame. He's covered us with grace, and therefore we are set free. Sing, You Broke My Chains.
You broke my chains of sin and shame, and You covered me with grace. You made my life Your holy fire, and You covered me with grace.
Let's sing that again. You broke my chains.
You broke my chains.
Just
out to say, I am set free.
broken voices.
I am set free, O Lord. It is for freedom that I am set free.
Amen. Amen. What does that freedom look like? One aspect of what that freedom looks like is unity, fellowship, being willing to just kind of open your hands up with what God has given you and surrender whatever He's blessed you with back to Him, to allow Him to use it however He wants to. And being reminded that, as this next song says, the riches of this world will fade, but the treasures of our God remain. So we empty ourselves, we pour ourselves out before God, we take everything that He's given us and we surrender it back to Him to be used for His glory, for His purposes, for His kingdom, however He wants to use it. And we take hands that once were tight-fisted and we open them up. And we're willing to give, we're willing to surrender whatever in our lives for the sake of His kingdom, for the sake of His church, for the sake of the gospel, for the sake of eternity, recognizing these things that are tightly in our hands are temporary. We open up our hands, God could use those for great eternal purposes. And so as you've been set free today, may you also surrender to whatever His will is for your life.
The riches of this world will fade. The treasures of our God
the riches of this world.
The riches of this world will fade. The treasures of our God remain. Here I empty myself to all this world and find everything.
You, oh Lord, I find everything in
So what happens if the church as a whole is willing to surrender all to God, all to Jesus? If we're willing to surrender all, one of the things you'll see is something that's encouraged throughout Scripture. Just a few selections. If you search the idea of unity in the Bible, you can scroll for a while. You can scroll for a while and you'll see things like this. 1 Corinthians 1:10. I appeal to you, brothers, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and the same judgment. 1 Peter 3:8. Finally, all of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. Philippians 2:2. Complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Psalm 133:1. Behold, how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. 2 Corinthians 13:11. Finally, brothers, rejoice, aim for restoration, comfort one another, agree with one another, live in peace, and the God of love and peace will be with you. Ephesians 4:3, be eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. Romans 12:4 through 5, for as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ and individually members one of another. Then Romans 12:16, live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Never be wise in your own sight. Philippians 1:27, only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear of you that you are standing firm in one spirit with one mind, striving side by side for the faith of the gospel. Acts 4:32, now the full number of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one said that any of the things that belonged to him was his own, but they had everything in common. So we see over and over again this idea of unity, of community and fellowship together as a key theme for the church then and the church now. We're reminded by Jesus, he says, they will know you are my followers by your love for one another. So let's sing together. We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. We pray that all unity may one day be restored, and they'll know we are Christians by our love.
We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. And we pray that all unity may one day be restored. And we'll know we are Christians by our love.
Christians by our love.
Lord God, would you continue to grow that unity among your people here? That our community, our workplaces, our families would know who we are, know who we follow by our love for one another, by our love for them. But may we be unified in you. May we experience this fellowship that is described in the early church. God, give us a great heart of surrender to you, because you've given us everything now and for eternity. Help us to live open-handed in a way that honors and glorifies you and shows your glory, your goodness, your love to the people around us. Holy Spirit, work now. Teach us. Teach us as we study your word. Help us to understand it. Illuminate it for us, that we might walk out of here with better understanding, better insight to walk and live every day for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. God be seated. Well, good morning, Water's Edge.
Good morning.
The Lord God has given us another beautiful day to worship Him, and we praise Him for that. Last Sunday was such a blessing, and I love the breeze, but I forgot my clip, so let me see if I can get my Bible to stay open where we will be this morning. And just give me 1 second here. Alright, if you have your Bibles and want to follow along with me, I will be reading the scripture, so you'll be able to, I pray, just hear and listen and ask the Spirit of God to allow these words of truth to just speak to your mind and heart and transform us in the moment. But I'll be in Acts chapter 2, beginning in verse 42 through 47. Acts chapter 2, beginning in verse 42 through 47, as we continue our story of looking at the early church in the book of Acts. The book of Acts simply means the Acts of the new church. The Acts of the early church, rather, the time after Christ had ascended back to be with God the Father. He sent back the Holy Spirit to be with us. The Holy Spirit was with the people, and God began to birth His church, if you will. And so many actions were taking place. And so the book of Acts is all about the actions of the early church. And we're walking through the book of Acts this year. And so we're in chapter 2, beginning in verse 42 through 47. I was looking at some notes this week from a time when I'd been through the book of Acts once before. And I realized it'd been quite a long time, all the way back to 2001. And so I was wondering if I had any notes on this particular text. And so I was looking at some notes, and I came across some notes. I saw at the top of the notes, it said 9/16/2001. I thought 9/16, that sounds, kind of rings differently than other dates. And why was that significant? What is the importance of that? And I realized in the moment, 9/16, that's just a few days, must have been the first Sunday after 9/11/2001. 9/16/2001 is a few days, the first Sunday after 9/11. As many of you all know, that was a very challenging day for our nation, a very dark day in many ways. Many things we give God praise for came out of that, but in the midst of that darkness, when terrorists chose to do evil and to run, you know, planes into the Twin Towers in New York, or into the Pentagon building, and thousands died in our nation. It was a dark day. It was a challenging day. It was a fearful day in many ways. And so this was the first Sunday after 9/11 that I first looked at this text and sought to seek God's direction and God's sovereign will for us as a people to comfort us then. I was in a different context from a church standpoint, but what I remember about that Sunday was this, and it was something that I had expected having become a pastor and studying the life of the church and how church flows oftentimes in our culture in America, and how certain cultural events can draw people out to want to seek God's face, and then usually certain things drift after that. And so it was no different on this Sunday, 9/16/2001. The church where I was pastoring was packed out. It was full house, right? It was a loaded gathering of the people. And why is that? Well, you can understand. It was a challenging week for us as a nation.
People were frightened. People were scared. In many instances, uncertain about our future. Certainly, hearts were broken and burdened for those who lost their lives in the carnage and the wreckage in New York and in D.C. Burdened about praying for the first responders who were still going into the rubble to see if they could find life that was still living. And so it's just a very difficult week and month and year for us. And so people came together that Sunday to seek the Lord's face. And I was grateful for that, grateful to try to seek to, by God's grace, point us to Him. And so we sought to ask God, God, reveal yourself to us, lead us as your people. Well, the next Sunday there was less people than there were that Sunday, and then the week after that there were less than that 9/16 Sunday, and a month passes, 2 months passes, and we were back to the normal gathering of people, and that great crowd that was almost probably a third larger on that Sunday eventually dwindled away and were no longer to be seen. That's pretty common, not just for a church where I was back 20 years ago, but churches across the nation. Many pastors write about the church life, will speak about these things. And so what we saw on that day, a cultural event brought people out to seek the face of God. And we praise God for that. We praise for the people in Christ, that anytime God draws people, everyone's always welcome. And we want people to hear about the gospel. We want people to hear about the good news and the hope that we have in God. If you're watching online today, we want people, we pray, people we don't even know may come and see us online to hear about the gospel and the good news of Christ. If you're visiting, we may not know you. You are welcome. We're grateful you're here. And you may be in Christ, you may not be in Christ. We may not know that, but we want you to hear about God and the goodness of God. And so we are grateful that all those people gathered, right? But we also know and we see that oftentimes a cultural event can draw people out to seek the face of God. But oftentimes genuine devotion for God, genuine devotion in Christ, a genuine passion for Jesus because He's transformed your life, is reflected in not so much a one Sunday attendance of gathering with people of God. It's a devotion, it's a desire, it's a delight. It's also a duty that begins to become a part of you because you've been transformed by the Spirit of God, having placed your faith by God drawing you into the person and work of Jesus. As we shared last week, you understand that Christ crucified, bled out for you, and you understand that Christ is risen and sits at the right hand of God, and because you have placed your faith in this Christ who has given of Himself so that you can be freed from sin and been brought into relationship with God, because you believe that with a passion, your devotions have completely changed in many ways in your life. And part of those devotions are you desire to be with the body of Christ. There's something about being together, something about being gathered with other believers who have a similar passion to seek after God. And so I saw the devotions, they dwindled pretty quickly after that one Sunday. And so I understand that devotion is important. And what we'll see this morning in this early church is that we looked at last week after this great sermon of Peter led by the Spirit of God at their great event called Pentecost, which is like our Lake Fest, right? Or maybe there was a wine fest yesterday. Many people gathered. It's like a big festival. People are gathering, and they're gathering for this festival to celebrate the goodness of God. And Peter gets up and says, listen, let me tell you about the goodness of God. He has come and revealed Himself in the Messiah, the Savior who saves us. He was crucified, buried, and He's risen. So he proclaimed that message, and it tells us at the end of the story last week that some 3,000 people were added to the church. Not added to a building, not added to a campus, added to the church, the body of Christ. The church is not a building. It's us, those of us who are in Jesus. 3,000 people. That's larger than the population in the town of Clarksville. We're like 1,200 people in the town limits. 3,000 people in one event of preaching and teaching the gospel, and God chose to add the numbers to His fellowship. Pretty cool. Well, if it's genuine, I would think there's going to be some changes in their lives. There'll be some things that, okay, then show their devotion to the things of God. And so that's exactly what we're going to see this morning. As we walk through the storyline then that'll be applicable for us today, we're going to see there are certain devotions that become a part of who you are because you're in Christ. And it happens this morning, we're going to see 8 of them. And if you were here last Sunday, don't get too nervous. We said there were 10 repetitions of the resurrection, and we got through all 10, and we still had lunch, and everybody was cool, right? Well, we've got 8 again today, and if you've been around Water's Edge for several years, you know, normally if it's 8, that means like maybe 8 hours, but it won't be 8 hours. But I don't mind that, just so you know, the Spirit leads. So these are 8 devotions that we're going to see that are tied to these dedicated disciples of Christ. They have given their lives over. God has drawn them to believe in Jesus. They're dedicated. They're all in. And now they're going to be devoted to this kingdom vision, and what does it look like? And so what we're going to see in the life of the church, really, we're seeing part of it today by the reason we're gathered here. Same thing they were doing then, we're doing now. And so these devotions, we want to be a part of our life as well. Now, we'll probably see at the end of the storyline from Dr. Luke, who wrote this for us, a doctor, a great historian, that the church sometimes can wrongly apply things we see in the scriptures. And so I just want to be kind of clear on the outset that we're not looking at these eight things that I think you'll remember all eight things come tomorrow morning or even tonight. You may not. If you're working in your scriptures, you'll see, and it'll become part of who you are, and it'll just be kind of intuitive. You'll know these things are part of your Christian life, but you may not remember all eight tomorrow. I may forget all eight come Wednesday, even having to preach the message, but as I'm in the Word and you're in the Word and we're in the Word together, it's like we're taking this meal, and this meal sustains us, this meal feeds us, this meal matures us and strengthens us, and so we need to take it in, and these things will just be a part of who we are. It's not necessarily eight things like, well, here are eight steps to do in your life that can just immediately change the direction maybe of challenges or struggles, temptations, success for the church. Oftentimes with church growth experts will say, hey, we see eight things here, and they'll usually identify four, identified eight, but they'll say, hey, here's eight things. Do these eight things, and guess what? We'll have a reaping of a harvest of 3,000 people just like they did at Pentecost. It doesn't say that. And you'll see the evidence for that as we get to the close of our time together this morning, so don't let me forget to come back to that. It's not necessarily eight steps that we do this, and this is what will happen. These are eight, yes, to help us kind of walk through it, but I just want to share with you, these are devotions that just flow out of people who are passionate and in love with Jesus Christ, their Lord and Savior. They love Jesus. We love Jesus, that's why we're gathered here today. And so in the storyline, I'll kind of walk through slowly instead of reading it all at one time, and we'll see these devotions. But remember, the context is Peter preaches, 3,000 people come into the church, place their faith in Christ. The Spirit of God comes upon them, and they're baptized. They have this public profession and so forth. They become genuine believers of Christ. And so what now, right? Where's the devotion now? What's that look like? Well, let's look and see what the Scriptures teach us about what it looks like to have this devotion in the Lord. Now the wind's blowing this way, Ryan. And so you labeled me this way, held me up this way, and I was going this way. All right, so here we go. Number one, it says in verse 42, and they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Another translation might read it this way, that the people then devoted themselves to the doctrines of the church, the doctrines of the scriptures. And doctrine is not really a politically correct word in our current culture. I'd say, unfortunately, it's not even a politically correct word inside the church that you hear very often. Well, you're all about doctrine. I'm about loving Jesus. Well, just so you know, there's no divide there. If you genuinely love Jesus, you are genuinely going to love His Word, because that's what doctrine is. The doctrine is simply the truth of God. It's not something, well, you're all about doctrine and theology, I'm all about Jesus, and so we're different somehow. No. If I genuinely love Jesus, it's because I know Jesus by how? By His revealed Word to me, His inspired Scriptures. And so I'm going to be about doctrine. I'm going to be about truth. I'm going to be about the Word of God. I'm going to be about Scripture, because that's how God has chosen to reveal Himself to us. It's not by the apostles here today speaking to you. It's by the Word of God here today and us unfolding it together. Does that make sense? And so the apostles then were all about the gathering of the church then was all about the apostles' teaching. The apostles were those who had seen with their own eyes the death and the burial and the resurrection of Christ. And they were given this then calling and command to go for and teach and make disciples by preaching the things that Christ had revealed to them. Out of the Old Testament Scriptures, the fullness of the Old Testament Scriptures, and then the Scriptures they would write. And so the early church is following the book. All right, you with me? They're simply following the book. It's God's Word. Paul, another apostle of Jesus, would later write this to a young pastor named Timothy. He says, listen, Timothy, the Word of God is God-breathed. It's God-given. It comes from God. It's God-inspired. It's by the Holy Spirit. And the Word of God is God-breathed, and it's profitable for instruction, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that, why? So that the people of God may become complete and equipped for every good work. The Word of God, it has value to us. And as we're in the Word of God, wow, we are corrected, we are instructed, we grow in our righteousness, which means we grow like Jesus. We grow in a way to walk rightly, and we become complete and full and mature is what that means. We become mature in such a way that we then are prepared for the good work of the kingdom. And so how do we get there? By being a people of the book, of the doctrine. Doctrine is truth. Jesus said what? Jesus said, I am the way and the truth, right? And I'm the life, and no one comes to the Father through me. It's through the teachings of Christ. It's through the revelation of God's word. I think with the book of Acts, it'll probably happen often, so I don't think I'll apologize. I'll just like give you a heads up as I go along. I reflect many times on my early days in Christ. And I know in 1995 that, as we talk about the Holy Spirit specifically, how the Holy Spirit's at work in the church, in 1995, I believe, is when God genuinely converted my life into Him. And one of the reasons I believe that, and the evidence is for that, is that in 1995, when God drew me, began to draw me, and I surrendered my life to Him, although I confessed, yes, at a young age, at 7, and we can talk about that, wrestle that, how does God work in those ways at another time. But in 1995, when I was saying, Lord, you've got me. I don't know why you'd want me. But, you know, I'm not worthy, but you've got me. I'm following you. I'm all in. I'm devoted to you. And one of the things I remember about 1995, when God transformed my life, is that the book, this word, the scriptures, right? That to me was just a book of stories, things I learned as a kid, things I was taught as a kid, grateful for those things. But what I learned about the book in that season, 1995, it came alive for me. It wasn't like, you know, like Shakespeare in high school, like, you know, pull my teeth out to read it, right? It was like, it became alive to me. It was a living book. It was like breathing to me. It was like transforming to me. It was like changing my life. And I had a desire to get into it. I had a delight to get into it. And it was transforming as I would get in the Word, and I saw it changing my life. It became alive. That's the Holy Spirit, church. That's how the Holy Spirit works. The Holy Spirit within us, it gives us a desire for doctrine, a desire for truth. And so the Holy Spirit has drawn these people to Himself in Christ, and now He gives them a desire to be in the Word. Let me ask you a question. Are you devoted to the Word of God? Are you devoted to Scriptures? Are you devoted to delighting in learning more about Him? The reality is sometimes it will be duty. And that you may not like that word. Well, it's a duty. It's not a delight. Well, sometimes life's like that. And I'm just going to be honest with you. Sometimes it might be that way getting into the Word of God. And when it's more duty than delight, we need to confess it to Christ. And say, hey, give me more delight than duty. But sometimes the duty, it turns to delight. It's like I was thinking this morning over here at the Sabre baseball field. Little kids playing baseball. It's kicked off again this spring. Praise God for that. Getting back to some normalcy. Little kids playing baseball. And little kids would be in that batting cage probably every night this week. Some little kid would be in there with his dad, swinging that bat over and over and over again. Now, some of the kids that are in there are going to say, Dad, I don't want to be here tonight. I don't want to practice baseball. Is that Bob right there? Bob and Susan, good morning to you guys. I just like, who is that? Great to have Bob back. So they're playing baseball, right? And Dad, I don't want to be here. It's like a duty. It's like a chore, right? And so they don't want to be practicing. But then if they practice long enough and it comes game time, under the lights here in Clarksville, right? The little kid's out there and, you know, big eyes and the ball's coming at him and he swings that bat like he did in practice every time. And he hits the ball and it goes past the infield and he gets that hit and runs to base, whatever. And he gets to first base, maybe second base. It's going to be, yeah, right. It's going to be that joy, that delight. That delight came out of the duty. Are you with me? I do the same thing with Scripture. Sometimes it feels like more heavy, like duty, but if we go to God's Word and we pray it up and ask God to give us the light, that oftentimes He reveals Himself to us. And the reality is, to know how to live in a way that honors God, if we're in the Word and we obey God's ways as we know God's ways, Jesus says, the Father will love you and I will love you and I will reveal more of myself to you, John 14:21. We get more of God, right? We get more of Him. So the early church, they said, hey, they were all about the apostles' doctrine and teaching. Why? Because they knew that it was good for them. They knew it was Spirit-led. But not only that, it says here, devoted followers also were all about the fellowship. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship. I like to think of fellowship just like hang time. The Greek word you're probably familiar with, koinonia, you know, this hang time of believers hanging out together, enjoying each other's company and fellowship and friendship, and just like to be around among other believers is what's taking place here in the church. They wanted to be a part of the fellowship, spending time together, in Christ. I was thinking this week, I had the chance to catch up with another brother who'd been gone for quite some time. Welcome back, Tom and Pam. But Tom and I got together with Levi. We were taking a trip to Durham, North Carolina. And Tom had been away all winter long in Florida. He's back now. And so God worked out for us to take this trip. And I needed Tom's advice and wisdom on something. And so we're taking this trip. And so along the trip, we get to catch up. I hear about some of the things that took place in Florida. I hear about some things going in his life and how Pam's doing and so forth. And he heard some things about my life. As a matter of fact, while we're traveling to Durham, I get a text in that Levi read for me that my mom, who's in her early 80s, had fallen and had a big knot on her head. And they're taking her to the ER to get it scanned and so forth to make sure she was okay. And so it kind of got heavy. There was gladness about Florida. Then there was gravity that came into the truck. But we just shared friendship and we prayed as we went along to that event and so forth. And then made our way back. And so just the friendship of catching up, the friendship of fellowship together in Christ and having a brother there with gladness and gravity, it was just an enjoyable time. Where is Tom? Tom, you're here. Yeah. We just enjoyed that. Welcome back, Pam. It just the friendship, the fellowship, right? And so I don't really even know Tom that well in some respects, right, Tom? We're getting to know each other. So what bonds us together, right? Jesus. That's the way it was for the other church. You think this roll call of the nations we saw a few weeks ago, all these different people that had come there to Israel, to Jerusalem rather, to celebrate this festivity, that they all knew each other, had all things in common? We'll see that in a moment. No, but what they had that unified them was Jesus. That's why I was delighted to see Bob, because Bob was at men's prayer yesterday morning, and I remember as we were praying, I thank God for Bob being here. And just like right now, I got emotional. I was like, why in the heck am I getting emotional? We're giving God praise that Bob is here. And Susan are back. You know, I was grateful for that. And I thought, what is that all about? And I know what it's about. It's about friendship. And I can say the same thing as I said about Tom. I'm still getting no bond. We're early in our friendship. Maybe it's like 2 years, 3 years, right? Some of us have known each other for years, right? And so it takes time to get to know each other. So why was I emotional? It's because what I've seen sometimes in the church, and something I've also read about as well, that with COVID-19, the past couple years, that some churches who aren't gathering anymore are not holding on to their friendships, is that they're not getting together, they're not collecting themselves together. And I've been reading, I don't know if it's true or not, but I've been reading that many churches will close their doors as a result of COVID-19. Why is that? Why has it got to be that way? And so when I saw Bob, I hadn't seen Bob in months, right? And so Bob's back. And so what? Why is that important to me? It's because I see that the friendship is still connected. And I would ask, what connects us? Our background, our field of experience, where we're from? He's from New York. I'm from the Show Me State, Missouri. No, what connects us is Jesus. And because it's Jesus, we can stay together, even if COVID-19 separates us for a while. Are you with me? It's Christ. It's a friendship. And so these guys are fellowshipping together. This means hanging out together, wanting to be among each other, fellowshipping together, friendship together in various ways. There's just a common bond that they appreciate. And so that was part of their devotion. And therefore, God calls us as well then to be a people that hangs out, spends hang time together, fellowship together. Do you love the body of Christ? Do you love the friendship in Christ? Do you pray about friendships in Christ? And here's a thought to think about, to wrestle with. If there's no desire to be among the body of Christ, do you really think that Christ is a part of you? The people he bled out for, and you have no desire to be among the people that he bled out for, do you really know Jesus who bled out for the same people you won't be around? There's something that's missing there. I'm not saying you may not know Christ or may not be salvation there, but I have no problem with planting seeds. Hey, wrestle with that a little bit. Because something's wrong there. When you are generally put into Christ, he puts it within you a desire to fellowship with the body of Christ. That's the people. And so they're devoted to doctrine. They're devoted to fellowship. They're also devoted to the breaking of bread. Four things up front are mentioned really closely together. Doctrine, fellowship, and then the breaking of bread. And you might be saying, we don't use that terminology in our normal day in life, typically. And so breaking of bread, you're saying, okay, what does that mean exactly? When you say they're devoted to breaking your bread, what does that mean? I'm going to break it down for you, right? It's real simple. It means they're having barbecue together. Duh. Pretty simple, right? That's all it means. That's what, if you, okay, go home, study the Greek for yourself. That's what it means. It means they're having barbecue together. They're breaking bread. They're having meals, right? There's a gladness and fellowship and friendship, and there's something about breaking bread together Right? It's funny, we got back from that Durham trip. Actually, Reed came up and saw us exchanging, getting out of cars and so forth here in the parking lot where we had gathered to go to that Durham trip. And it was like 6:30. We knew it just passed like dinner time. And Reed said, "You guys were in Durham and came back. Did you get barbecue? Right? Did you break bread up there?" kind of thing. And it's just something fun and enjoyable about breaking bread together, right? Sharing a meal with a brother or sister in Christ, with a family in Christ, there's something that's special about that. Here's something to look forward to. I can't wait when we get this facility done over here. People come in all the time and say, "Well, Bo, are you guys going to make a bunch of classrooms in here? You're going to have like 20 classrooms. You got all this open space." And we say, "Absolutely not. It's wide open in there. Why is it wide open? So we can have big fellowship dinners together." And here's what we want to do. We want to invite the whole community to right here to break bread with us. And as we break bread, we'll fellowship, we'll develop friendships, we'll talk about Jesus. And then we know there's with that gladness, also a little bit of gravity, but the gravity goes to gladness as well. We'll also partake of the Lord's Supper. I think it was both. It was just hanging out, having meals together. But then also the Lord's Supper is something Jesus said to do before he went back to be with God the Father. And he said, "Do this until I return." And so we take of the wine, we take of the bread that's symbolic of the broken body of Christ, the sacrifice of Jesus. We partake of those things to remember our great God in Christ Jesus, who's brought our salvation to us. And so it's both and. So they're devoted to doctrine, they're devoted to fellowship, they're devoted to the breaking of bread. The next one he says, right after that, he says, and they're devoted to prayer. These aren't really, just off the charts things, are they? Just things we see, just like, hey, that's kind of cool. I hope you're kind of encouraged as we go along. Are we about teaching? That's what we're doing right now. Are we about fellowship? That's what I just mentioned a few moments ago. So I would gather out here on the yard. Are we about breaking bread? Yeah, I bet some of you all here gathered, broke bread yesterday together, probably more than likely. And are we about prayer? And yes, we need to be about prayer. God's church, God's people is to be a house of prayer, right? And so we pray, we call upon God. We delight in showing our dependence upon Him, that He's in control. We need Him, we want Him, obviously. And so we pray, we call upon the name of the Lord in all that we do. I was thinking about the blessing when we gather and we pray, and we get to celebrate prayers. Oftentimes in the past, when we're inside our building, we have testimony time. It's a little more difficult to do outside, but we have a testimony time. But I was thinking about prayers here just recently. At the end of the service, like 2 weeks ago, we had closed up service and we were leaving, and a young lady had shared with me about how she gotten this job. And I said, "Wait a minute." And so I blurted out to the whole congregation, "Hey, everybody wait just a second," because I got excited because we had been praying for her that the door might open for a job here in Clarksville. She wouldn't have to travel all the way to Durham anymore for her job, and she'd be right here locally. And so we shared that news and we celebrated that news, and we believe that God enabled us to be a part of the joy in that is because we have been what? We have been praying for that to happen. Right? Last Sunday, I see little Kevy back there and the Paulsons, and last Sunday they were back, and little Kevy's doing well. And so we have been praying for his health, and now he's healthy. And so guess what? Because we pray, we also get the joy of rejoicing over the answered prayers. We don't get to control how prayers are answered, by the way. They're always answered according to God's will. But we get to be a part of that. And that's a blessing that God gives the church. And so we see the people then we're devoted to prayer. Yesterday morning, we have men's prayer at 7 a.m. Just kind of plant that seed. If you ever have free time, there's no legalism here. If you're free time, men are always down here at 7 o'clock on Saturday mornings to pray. Sometimes you can make it, sometimes you can't. But if you've never been a part of it, I want to encourage you. Let me say this. If you've never been a part of it, I'm going to encourage you to pray about that. To pray about, why am I never desiring to be a part of men to pray? And I see that as part of devotion of God. I want to encourage you. Just make that a part of your week somehow, your weekend. I mean, once a month, two times a year, occasionally come out and want to pray with other men. There's something that's powerful about that for the church, for all of us. Amen. But yesterday, so we're praying. I happened to be sitting next to the Tom. And you guys get nervous every time you hang around me. You think, man, is he going to bring up my name on Sunday mornings? Well, I might, but by God's grace, you pray for me. I always do it in a respectful way. So I'm sitting next to Tom, and he begins to pray. And we're praying about different things. We're praying and we're praising. We give up our needs or requests. We also praise things. And so I'm sitting next to Tom, and you know what Tom prayed for? He prayed for my mom, who had fallen, that he learned about the night before. He interceded on behalf of me and my family. You think that blessed me that morning? Amen. Oh, heck yeah. I was so grateful for that, that I got lifted up. My family got lifted up. My mom's probably watching online, and she's doing well. And so we praise God for that. And so we just pray. We lift each other up. We lift up requests. We lift up praises. And so we are to be a people of prayer. So that's four devotions I see in the early church. And then Peter, rather Luke, shares these words about what was taking place. He says, "And all came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles." And so wonders and signs being done by these who had seen the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, who are teaching the things about Jesus. It tells us that the church was in awe. Another translation would say fear. It's kind of a combination of awe and fear. And like, whoa, wow, God's doing something really incredible here. And then wonders and signs. I'm not going to camp out on that this morning, but the wonders and signs were happening through the apostles. And the apostles were all about, as we've already seen from Peter, spotlighting the person and work of Jesus. The wonders and signs had great purpose to help people understand this message you're hearing. This message is true about the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. Jesus Christ sits at the right hand of God the Father, and He is God. He is the Messiah. Place your hope in Him. And so great awe, great fear is taking place. And then listen to number five, this fifth devotion. Listen to what it says. "And all who believed," this is verse 44, "and all who believed were together and had all things in common." Everyone who believed, these people were together and had all these things in common. And so I see them being devoted to unity. Pastor Ryan, I think, read a number of verses about unity today. And so it says that all the people who had come to Christ, and as they were gathering and fellowshipping, they had all these things in common together. And I began to think about that, like, wait a minute. What does that mean? I think in the context, it's speaking about things that they're doing as a part of being a part of the body of Christ, like prayer and the teachings and the fellowship and breaking of bread together. But when it says they had everything in common, I thought about that and I thought, you know what? There's no way they had everything in common in one sense, right? And I thought about Peter, and one who comes on the scene here shortly after in the book of Acts is the Apostle Paul. I think those guys were, you know, the complete opposites, probably, right? Peter was a fisherman from Galilee, right? He's out casting nets, you know, out in the hot sun all day long or in the early mornings. And Paul was a man from the city, if you will, a trained theologian, an academician, a scholar, a bookworm, a scribe. And so you've got Peter out in the country fishing. You've got Paul in the cities studying theology. And by God's Spirit, He draws them both to place their faith in Christ. And when those two are together, I would say in many respects, they had nothing in common. Their backgrounds, their fields of experience in various ways, yes, they had some things in common, but probably many things not in common. But yet what we see here, the early church had everything in common. And so what unifies all these people where they say, hey, we've got something in common here. There's a unity among us, and we wanted to be devoted to unity. We want to keep this unity. And this bond that we have together, we've already shared at church, but it's our identity in Jesus, right? It's our identity in Christ. Our identity in Jesus, it gives us this common bond, this unity. And so they argue, argue's not the right word. I think they hold on. They devote themselves. They're passionate about unity as a people of God. And I don't know if they ever wrote down that principle back then. I think it just flowed out of what it meant by being a Spirit-filled church that loved the Lord. They are devoted to unity. They're devoted to things in common. I think what's in common is Christ at its center. Well, listen where it goes on from there. It says, "And they were selling their possessions and belongings and giving away, distributing the proceeds to all as any had need." Wow, that's a tough one. Oftentimes in the church, they were selling their possessions and belongings and giving away the proceeds to everyone who had a need. Well, they had things in common. There's great unity. And now we see them being a giving people. They're devoted to doctrine. They're devoted to fellowship. They're devoted to breaking of bread. They're devoted to prayer. They're devoted to unity. And they're also devoted to giving. Being a very gracious and giving people here is what we see from the early church. The Holy Spirit was all over them. They were filled with the Spirit. And this is a natural outflow of being full of the Spirit of God. Well, we can't camp out on any one of these devotions, and neither can we do on this one. Giving is something that's taught much by Christ. Many verses about giving and teaching and what that giving and what that means from his teaching. But just let me say this. It doesn't mean here, from what's kind of hot politically in our culture, this text is not about communism. It's not about socialism. Just from a biblical standpoint, a biblical worldview, it would actually be undermined if you tried to place that upon these scriptures, because what we see here, the church is selling its possessions and belongings and then giving collectively to various people who had needs. It's all done voluntarily as the Spirit of God leads each individual person. Are you with me? It's voluntarily. One of the commandments that God has given us is thou shalt not steal. So it's impossible to steal if you have no possessions that are yours. It's okay to have possessions. It's okay to enjoy things. But what we see here in the early church, there were in this special need of transitional history for the church, there were special needs there in Jerusalem, and people were willing to give, though, and give graciously. I thought about Peter. Peter was a fisherman from Galilee, and now he's leading the early church. He has probably a family, right? He probably has certain financial needs, and he needs to eat, and he needs to provide for his family back home. Maybe his family transported themselves to Jerusalem, but he's involved in overseeing and carrying out and teaching and being a missionary for the early church. How was he going to make his living and be full-time at what God had called him to? I'll tell you how. It's through the body of Christ. Giving. And so there were special needs at this season of the church. It may be a little bit different for us today, but we still, as God's people, want to give. We want to collectively give of our tithes and offerings in various ways. And as we give, God works through that for the gospel to expand. That's our mission here. Are you guys with me on that? We have two chests over here. The chest closest to me is we're trying to do this building debt-free so we don't have a burden on ourselves and we don't have a burden on advancing the gospel. We'll do it debt-free. We don't want to be a slave to any lender. And then on the left here, that chest is just a general offering, general budget to carry out the ministry needs of the church. Things that aren't very exciting, like electric bill, right? Or parking lot expenses, various things that we have to oversee and do. But we give because God says that he delights in a cheerful what? A cheerful giver, right? A cheerful giver. So we need to be giving. Let me ask you, are you a giver? Do you give? Does God's Spirit have anything within you to want to give to the body of Christ? Do you see the needs of the church? Do you trust the leadership of the church to give to collectively? Then the leadership and so forth, as we interact with the body of Christ, we figure out how God's working through us to minister and to move out in our community, to use the funds for the advancement of the kingdom, advancement of the gospel. God doesn't need our money, but he calls us to be givers that way. Are you giving in that way? If you're led by the Spirit of God, you are going to be a giver. If you're not being led by the Spirit of God and you're in your flesh, you're going to be like this with your giving. And God's saying, be like this. It's yours to manage. Your possessions are yours. It's your stewardship. But God says, don't be so tight-fisted. Be a giver. Because God delights in a cheerful giver. And I was thinking about this morning. What I've seen, just take it for what it's worth, over 20 years being a pastor. I was in the pharmaceutical business prior to coming to becoming a pastor. So I was in business, a lot of finances and so forth, a lot of different numbers to work with than inside the church. But I've seen finances from different perspectives as a pastor and as a corporate business person. And what I've seen inside the church all the times is those who may, you can sense, aren't really free to give, right? They're not mature in their relationship with Christ to give. They're not loving Jesus enough by the Spirit of God to give. Then it usually reflects there's a missing link in their true devotion to Christ. If you love Jesus, then you love to give to the church for Jesus, to the ministries of the church. If you're not really in love with Jesus, or you're more devoted to money than you are to the master, then you give less. That's just my observation. So take it for what it's worth. I say it in love, but God loves a cheerful giver, and we want to be cheerful givers here at Water's Edge. And we don't always control our giving. It may be both and. Sometimes God may say, I want to give to this specific ministry, and then sometimes God's going to say, hey, just give generously with open hands and trust what God will do with it and hold us accountable as we go along. So giving, though, is a part of the early church. Pretty crazy giving right here, right? Pretty crazy giving. I got to move on because I love talking about stories about giving because God's been so good to us. He is our Jehovah Jireh and he has provided for us. And man, I'm so grateful for that. But when you're led by the Spirit, you're a giver. And a lot of times, no one's ever going to know how you give. It's just you and the Lord. And that's the way it should be. Well, not only giving, but also see gathering. Check out what they say next. It says, they were selling their possessions and giving, and then day by day, they're attending the temple together. Day by day, they're attending the temple together. And so what I see there from the early church, they have the temple. We've got this little campus here in the heart of Clarksville. And they're attending the temple together. And so they're collectively gathering as a people of God. They're doing exactly what we're doing right now. We are gathered together because we think that God says, hey, it's good to gather together as a people of God. In the book of Hebrews, it says we should not forsake what? The assembling of ourselves together. That's Hebrews 10, verse 24 and 25. We should not forsake the assembling ourselves together, but rather we should be meeting together to do what? In love, to stir up love within each other, so we might be stirring up also good works to be about the kingdom of God. It's kind of a paraphrase. But we're not to not meet. And so guess what? What we're doing right now, I hope you're encouraged. We need this. We whether online, if you're able to meet with us this way or gathered here, we need this. This strengthens us as a people of God. I believe in that. It's my conviction. Someone might say, well, I got burned at the church, so you know, so-called church, and so I just worship out on the lake. I love the lake. I love being out on the lake and saying, God, you're awesome. Look at the beauty out here, and worshiping out there on the lake. But I can't just worship there. I need this right here. Because God teaches it to me in the scriptures. And so if it's he says it's good, that means I need this from him. And you do as well. We need to be meeting as a people of God, not forsaking ourselves together, a meeting together, but coming together for the cause of Christ. And so they're gathering. You know what you miss when you don't gather? I'll give you a picture of this. And if you were here that Sunday, it's been a part of the community, the fellowship of Christ, you would have rejoiced in it. And this brother's here this morning, but I was thinking last fall, I guess, is Dub's here, and we brought Dub up on stage. So what's it, and we just thank God for Dub. So what's so special about that? Because Dub had a stroke months earlier in the warehouse working here, and he'd been gone from us for 2 months in Richmond, rehabbing and so forth, and then he was going to be heading away to Virginia, Florida for more rehab. But he came back, and he was walking, and he was upright, and he was clear, and he came up on stage, and we all rejoiced, and we celebrated. We've done that with a lot of different people over the years with our church family, and man, that was good for our soul. Are you with me? If you're not here, you miss that. You just do. You miss that opportunity. Like, man. And the more I think about it, Brother Bob got to bring a message this past fall after a very serious surgery where we really could have lost Bob. That's probably some of the emotion from yesterday. He could have not been here, but he's still here, and he's our friend, and so we're grateful for that. But if you weren't here to see Bob up preaching, like, man, that's the same guy who almost died like a month ago, and he's up here bringing the word, how cool is that? I don't want to watch that be a video. I want to be there, right? So there's just cool things over the years that have happened. And you say, well, is it going to happen this next Sunday, something really cool? I don't know. And so can you say, well, I'll come when it's the cool Sundays, right? Well, I know something's really going down that's kind of out of the ordinary. But let me encourage you with this. What we see here in the scriptures by these followers, these seven devotions so far, is one more to share, is that these are really not extraordinary things. These are just ordinary things of the body of Christ. Hey, we get together, what do? Oh, we get together and we gather as a people of God. We get together, what do? Oh, we pray. What do you guys, when you get together, what do? We have fellowship. What's that mean? It's kind of like, I know a Christianese word. It just means friendship. We just hang out with each other. Oh, really? We do that too. When you guys get together, well, we eat. You know, we like barbecue. We really do, yeah. And so we have barbecue and what else? Well, we like teachings. We believe in truth. You guys like truth, right? And so we believe truth has been revealed to us by God. And so, man, we've been living by truth, and we feel like God's been guiding us and really kind of watching out for us, because we've been walking in the truth, and there's just a stability in my life. There's a gratitude in my life. There's a centeredness in my life. And besides all those blessings that come from walking the Word of God, I've just discovered, you know, I love God. And I've been created to worship Him. And so we worship Him for His glory, kind of what we do, right? And we want everybody to know about it. Well, how does that word get out? Well, sometimes it takes finance. And so we give. You really give? Do you realize if you gave that much, you could have bought a new truck with that much money. Yeah, but we're about the kingdom of God. If God wants a truck or a boat, yeah, those things may come, and those things are enjoyable as well. But we give because why? We want everyone to know about the kingdom of God. when I want to know about what it means to have a relationship with God through Christ, and so we give. Those are just ordinary things we do. We just do those things. We just do them. Well, those aren't really extraordinary. I see here in the book of Acts, when the Holy Spirit came, like, whoa, you got to be kidding me. People are speaking other languages from all over the world, all these languages. Yeah, there are some extraordinary events in the scriptures that we see. And sometimes God does extraordinary things. And sometimes he lets us even see those things as well. But typically, church, I don't want to discourage you. I want to encourage you. It means if you're hanging in there, it's because the Spirit of God's giving you a value and a blessing to hang on to these things. Is most things are really, in some respects, ordinary, yes, but they are peculiar. But they're not out of the box. We can't promise you what God's going to do next Sunday. You know, if I shared my heart off some of this stuff I see in Acts, you know, I probably get all emotional because I see, like, last week, man, 3,000 people came to Christ. You think sometimes behind the scenes that we don't weep over stories like that? We see those things in the scripture. See, man, oh God, would you do that here? Would you do it right here in Clarksville? Save all of Clarksville. Give them a passion for Jesus. Oh yeah, we want the extraordinary. But hey, we just want to be about the faithfulness of God. And so we've seen seven ordinary things. And the last one is a good one too. You know, number two was pray. So the people pray, but they also, you know what they also do? It says in verse 8, they praise. Listen to this. And it's kind of a funny to get there. Listen to verse 46. Day by day attending the temple, that's a gathering together. And then it says, and breaking bread. Now we've already talked about breaking bread, right? So we can't talk about that again. I just think it's kind of cool that two times they talk about barbecue. I'm going to move on. So breaking bread in their homes, they love to eat together. They received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And so I'll just give you this number 8. It's praise. Devoted disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ, they love to praise God. They love to worship God. They love to just call upon God's name and say, God, you're awesome, and we're going to gather as people of God, and we're gonna give you praise. What you see grounded, what they're grounded in, at least is praise. It says they were gathering and meeting and doing these ordinary things, and it says they had these generous hearts, these gracious hearts. There's a glad, gracious heart, and it says they were praising God. A heart that's full of gratitude, you know what it does? It praises God. When you have a heart that's full of gratitude, man, you just love to praise God. It's like, God, you're good. Man, you are great. You are gracious. You're loving. You're kind. You're steadfast. And your love towards us, you know, your love never fails. You haven't left us alone. We're not orphans here. You've sent the Spirit of God back to be with us. You know, you're our Prince of Peace. You're our joy. You know, you're a rock in the midst of crisis. God, you're just everything. And so we gather collectively and privately. We want to praise you, because we're grateful for who you are, right? So that's what the people did. That's 8. Teaching, devoted to it, right? Fellowship, they were devoted to it. Breaking of bread, they were devoted to it. Prayer, they were devoted to it. Unity, had everything in common, they were devoted to it, right? Gathering, they wanted to gather, and so they gathered, they were devoted to it. Giving, they were givers, gracious givers, and so they were devoted to it. And then praise, I see them devoted to praise. Just ordinary things about being a part of the kingdom of God, part of a local church. And then Luke records this, finishes out recording this section by saying this, and the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. That's pretty cool. Man, way to go, God. The Lord added to their number day by day those who are being saved. And so that's where we got to be careful. We can say, hey, what if we do these 8 things? If we do these 8 things, then the Lord's going to add to our number day by day. And we're going to see this great movement of God, and the church is going to, you know, triple in size and so forth. And as you all know, it's not about the numbers, it's about the people we want to see come to Christ. And God might do this, but we see here it's not what the church does necessarily. It's not 8 steps and then all of a sudden we see the church explode. The church was being the church, led by the Spirit of God. And these are part of what it means to be a part of the Spirit of God-led church. And what God says here is that he chose to add to the church. Who did the adding? God. God added to his church day by day. And we're trusting God's adding to us according to his sovereign will for us. Amen. We just trust him with it, you know? We pray for great movements of God. Pray for revival in the church. Pray for, you know, just brokenness over sin and turn to Christ as the hope and solution. But we trust that God adds to his church. Let me ask you this morning, are you part of God's church? Maybe God's Spirit this morning is wanting to add you to the church. You say, well, I'm here. I don't mean that. I mean, are you part of the kingdom of God? Are you in Christ? Have you heard the Spirit of God draw you to the personal work of Jesus? Place your faith in Christ, repented of sin, hearing the Spirit of God say, God, I'm a mess without you. I'm not holy. I can't be in your presence. And God saying, yes, you can. You trust in Jesus. He becomes your righteousness. And through him, you can be with me. And you hear the Spirit of God leading you to that message. Have you truly received that message and surrendered yourself to the Lord? Maybe God's knocking at your heart today in your mind because he's wanting to add to his church. And if he is, come on in. Come on in. Be a part of the body of Christ. If you're in Christ this morning and you've seen all these evidences of just things that what it means to be a part of a true fellowship, living genuinely by the Spirit-filled filled life in Christ, then say, you know, I'm missing a few of these devotions. You know, not that we're keeping track of a list. We're not. We're not list people here, by the way. And this helps us walk through the Scripture sometimes. We're not lists. We're not legalism. It's not what we're about. We're about grace and the goodness of God. But if you see these things in God's Word, say, you know what? This devotion is not a part of me at all. This devotion here is not a part of me at all. Then maybe you become cold in your devotions in some ways. And I just want to ask God to bring conviction over you and pray up that coldness that he makes your heart warm again to be about those devotion items in his Word that he wants us to be a part of. That'd be my prayer. God, I've got coldness towards giving. I've got coldness towards fellowship. I've got coldness towards prayer. Coldness towards a Word right now. Well, we don't want you to drift. I don't want to drift. I pray for you. You pray for me. Elders, we pray for each other, right? And so let's pray for each other that God help us to be passionately devoted to the things that are Spirit-filled parts of being a part of a local church. And we know in the midst of that, man, you will glorify your name. We'll receive blessing from it. And we're going to have great hope that every Sunday, every day, as we live our lives out here in Lake Country, you're building your church. And for that, we can give praise. Amen. Amen. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your grace and your Word that teaches us with such clarity. So, Lord, we pray, would you stir in our hearts to be fully devoted to thee? Just fully all in for thee. And so as we grow in our faith, as we mature in our faith and see devotions, things that you want us to be acting upon and devoted to, Lord, by your Spirit, would you grow in us that desire to live these things out in a way that will bless your holy name? And Lord, we trust that you'll build your church according to your will for us. And Lord, we do pray for salvation. Pray for any salvation that needs to take place here today. We pray for our sanctification that needs to take place here today, Lord. Would you work in us afresh and anew? Lord, I confess my own sins before you. I intercede on behalf of the people. Lord, may we be a confessional people that confesses sin daily, weekly, Lord, that we will just stay prayed up and confessed up so we can be filled by your Spirit and walk in a way that glorifies you. And these things we see in the early church as they were led by the Spirit will also be seen in us. And so other people will see these things in us living out the kingdom of God. Lord, build your church and we'll give you all the praise. In Jesus' name, and God's people said, amen, amen. God bless you all. We shared last Sunday. In case you haven't heard, I want you to know that we love you on behalf of the elders here. And guess what? This is much more important. God loves you. Have a great week.